गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीबडी, स्पेशली पेशेंट्स हु आर हु जॉइंड इन नाउ टू लिसन टू अस. आई एम डॉक्टर ज्योति मेनन, द डायरेक्टर ऑफ इनफर्टिलिटी सर्विसेज, एंड विथ मी आई हैव डॉक्टर राजेश्वरी, वन ऑफ आर सीनियर कंसल्टेंट्स, एंड वी बोथ आर अटैच टू द गुणशीला ग्रुप ऑफ इनफर्टिलिटी सर्विसेज एंड गुणशीला ग्रुप ऑफ हॉस्पिटल्स. वी आर एट प्रेजेंट इन द बसवनगुड़ी ब्रांच. इन कंटिन्यूएशन विद आर पेशेंट एजुकेशन सीरीज एज पार्ट ऑफ आस्क गुणशीला, this will be the third episode, and today we will be discussing on why it is so important to look at the male factor also in a patient, a couple who comes to us with any kind of infertility problems. Evaluation of male factor becomes very, very important, as we will be discussing in the course of this particular live webinar which we are doing. And why it is so important for everybody to understand is also will be explained to you in a certain amount of detail in very simple language so patients can understand it. You can text in your questions either during the program, or if you want to do it at any other time, you can write into us at gunashila.com. So Rajeshwari, we'll go to the next one. As you know, that for many, many years now, it used to be thought that it is only the woman who is the cause of the infertility. And most of the time they will say, okay, you please go and test, nothing is wrong with me, without doing any tests on the men itself. Has that concept changed, and why has it changed? Is there any reason for that?
Yes. Initially, people were thinking that infertility is basically a women's problem. Men felt that by having intercourse and producing the semen sample, they were fertile and they were capable of fathering a child. But as the years progress and people are becoming more educated, and they are feeling that they also need to be evaluated, and it was found that 30% of the infertile couple problem was seen in the male. Now, because of education and men becoming more aware, they are coming for open and they are getting themselves evaluated.
Women also becoming more aware that it is not only their fault.
Yes.
So they insist that the men also need to be checked.
And one more thing is probably our lifestyle, that is obesity. All of them are becoming IT professionals, sitting in the AC room, working in front of the laptop. And so physical exercises has become very minimal. So and the type of food we eat, the junk food, all this is contributing for obesity, and then alcohol, smoking,
environmental pollution.
All this also may be contributing for the increase in the male fertility problems, what we are seeing right now, which is increasing to almost 50%.
So,
it was now, if you take what are the percentages, who is affected, how much, male are affected, problem is seen in 30% of the males in the infertile couple. Female also 30%, and in combined, that is 10% of the couple, both problem is seen both in the male as well as the female. And 25% of the couple, we are not able to find any gross obvious abnormality on investigation.
With both, everything being normal in both the men and the women, but like you have already emphasized and which I want to re-emphasize, it is very, very important that the men also come in for some basic investigations before we can declare them as being okay.
And it is also good practice, ma'am, because if there is any problem and we only concentrate on the women and we bombard the women with all type of investigations and injections and treatment, and later we find that man is also having, male partner is also having some subtle problem also, we can simultaneously treat and we will not be
wasting. The time to pregnancy is reduced if we investigate both the partners simultaneously. So,
first, I just want to start how the sperm looks and where it is produced. Sperm, as all of us know, it is produced in the testis, and it traverses and comes to the allomyxes along with the fluid part, that is the semen, and it is ejaculated or comes out during the intercourse. There are few parts where there can be abnormality. So, I just want to tell what are the parts of the sperm, so that later when we come to the analysis, we understand why it is important and what is it. There is a head, like all for us, what we have like eyes, nose, mouth. The sperm also has a head which contains the nuclear material or the genetic material, and it has got a cap. Cap is called as acrosome. that covers about 50 to 70% of the head, and this helps in attaching of the sperm to the egg, and it helps this genetic material to go into the egg and fertilization to happen and baby to be formed. Then it has got a neck piece and a tail. Tail is very important because it helps in movement, motility. This is the very important thing. When there is problem in the motility, the tail may not, means to say if there is not proper movement, then also the adequate number of sperms may not go reach the egg in the fallopian tube.
Okay, now it's important, that's just want to again emphasize that any the andrologist who basically looks at the sperm has to look at all these three portions.
Yes, ma'am.
Because individually they can contribute to problems. And they have to comment whether there is a head abnormality, whether there's a neck piece abnormality, or there is a tail problem. Okay. And that comes as part of morphology.
There are many causes which can give rise to this male infertility. One, there can be problem in the formation of the sperm itself, or the blockage can be there when it is coming out from
the testis
to the outside, or there can be morphological abnormality. All these three can contribute to the male infertility. And we need to know what are the important causes. It can be congenital. See, when there is fetal development, the testis develops inside the abdomen, that is inside the stomach. Then it gradually traverses and reaches the scrotum by birth. If at all there is arrest in this transport from the abdomen to the testis, to the scrotum, the testis can stay in the abdomen or in the abdominal wall where the temperature is slightly more than that in the
outside the body
in the
scrotal sac.
This higher temperature can have effect on the formation of the sperms.
Mm.
So we need to look for that. And if at all it is found, it has to be treated early. That is 6 months to 1 year of baby's life, maximum by 2 years of the child's life, we have to correct it. There can be difficulty in intercourse, that is erectile or ejaculatory dysfunction can be there. They may all be very subtle. So it could be due to psychological problem or any medication what they are taking also can contribute to that. Chromosome.
Or sometimes even maybe the anatomic placement of this thing, it can be
retrograde. Because of the weakness of the bladder neck, or due to any surgeries or medication which can weaken the bladder neck, that also can give rise to backward flow of the semen into the bladder and it gets mixed with the urine.
Sometimes even hypospadiasis, those kind of things can also cause some kind, not difficulty. Maybe not really difficulty, but difficulty in deposition of the sperm in the right place.
Mm. Then chromosomal and genetic factors. Chromosomal, when there is abnormality in this chromosome, that also can have influence on the spermatogenesis, that is formation of the sperm, like Klinefelter syndrome, where there is an excess chromosome or there is Y microdeletion. So it's very important to know this to counsel the couple later when the infertile couple come, whether there is any chance of the baby also inheriting. Same problem. If it is going to be a male child, whether it will have the same problem like the father.
And now we have, especially in our hospital, we have got the technique to do this, especially if they come for IVF. We are able to detect these kind of things from our TGS, what we have, the pre-genetic screening, testing. Okay.
And acquired can be any trauma, infection to the testes, or any surgery. These also can contribute to that. When there is a surgery, means to say in childhood, that is hernia repair, or even in the adult, hernia repair can cause blockage in the vas and there can be production, but it may not be coming. And we need to take a detailed history to find out if he has undergone, because patient may feel that may not be very important to tell us that he has undergone such surgeries. And then also...
But it does have an effect on the
spermatogenesis. Other medications which are used for blood pressure or psychotic, antipsychotics, these also can contribute to the male infertility. If there is, means to say, for chemotherapy or radiotherapy for cancer treatment, most of the drugs which are used for chemotherapy can have effect on the formation or the production of the sperm. So we usually recommend these people to freeze one or two samples of the semen and finish their chemotherapy. And then if at all there is no production of the sperm, they can utilize this frozen sample and father a biologically.
And we at Gunashila are doing this fertility preservation both for men and women honorary basis. We are not charging them anything at all. And for 10 years, the semen samples for the men and either the ovarian tissue or the embryos or the oocytes are all have been frozen for a large number of patients, maybe about 400 patients, as 400 men and about 35 to 40 women.
And now coming to the lifestyle, as I already told, obesity, alcohol, smoking, all these also can contribute to the formation and motility of the sperm.
Correct.
Then coming to this, what is varicocele? That is the dilatation of the
vessels. I'm sure a lot of men already must be have gone to some kind of people, doctors near their house, and they will say, okay, or done some ultrasound and say, you have a varicocele. So we just would like to explain to you what exactly a varicocele is.
It is the dilatation of the vessels in the scrotum. Because there is dilatation, increased vascularity will be there and the temperature will increase. This raised temperature can have effect on the formation of the sperm, one, two, on the motility as well. Just because there is a varicose vein, varicocele doesn't mean you have to correct it. If you correct,
so everybody doesn't require surgery.
Yes, definitely they do not require. And it depends on the count and motility. If it is very low count, by doing the surgery, it doesn't mean that it's going to come to normal. So that also needs to be explained to the patient. Before subjecting for them for the surgery. And retrograde ejaculation, as we already discussed before, that due to some weakness in the bladder neck, due to surgery or due to medication or even sometimes psychological also, there can be weakness and the sperm semen, instead of coming forward, can go backward and get deposited in the urine. And the urine is acidic. This can be harmful to the sperm. So we need to, if we come to know this person is having retrograde ejaculation, we can give pre-medication. Means to say, we can alkalinize that urine, collect it. We can give instruction how to collect, process that and get the sperms. These sperms can be used for IUI if they are of a good number. If it is less, we can use them for IVF or ICSI as well.
See, and in this particular case, especially for retrograde, what they actually present may be only azoospermia.
Correct.
And unless they give us a history or we go detail into that, then only we would look for semen in the urine.
Yes, ma'am.
Correct.
And one more thing is, when they give us a semen sample also, if they give us very minimal sample, like 0.1 ml, 0.2 ml, we need to ask them. Ask them what is the whether they had difficulty, did they spill the sample, and that will provoke us to think whether there is a blockage or whether there is retrograde ejaculation. Now coming to the, we finished what are all the maybe the causes. Now coming to evaluation, history, examination, investigation, that is the basic thing. First thing is history. A very good medical and sexual history needs to be taken. Examination, we don't subject everyone for examination. It depends on the history and investigation, like semen analysis where we do. If there is anything, that only will prompt us to go back to the examination of the physical examination.
Correct. Or some kind of like a phenotypical appearance.
Yeah.
Like Klinefelter's are very, very characteristic. So in those cases, we would like to do a physical examination. Especially what we would like to look for, the size of the testes, all those kind of things.
And hormone levels also for that.
Correct.
History, in coming to history, we need to take a detailed history of their sexual activity. People are married for 5-6 years and they come to us and they tell that we are not able to conceive and we want to take treatment. When we just get into a detailed history, we find that there is a non-consummated. They never ever had an intercourse. So these type of people, non-consummated marriage, these people by counseling and going into in depth and finding out what is the cause, and counseling may help them to conceive naturally. They will really not require any treatment, any type of ART treatment for
this
pregnancy.
Kind of thing. See, I also want to emphasize here that in this particular cases of non-consummation, you really need to look at the couple. Is it the wife's problem or is it the man?
Yes.
Accordingly, most of the time, it is just that they probably do not really know the technique, a proper technique of having a sexual intercourse. And all that they require is proper counseling. Maybe the wife requires a little bit of manual dilatation by a vaginal examinations. And we have found that quite frequently in our hospital. Then when it's like this and she's just a little bit very afraid of the whole process, if by gradually we are able to introduce one finger and then two fingers into the vagina, she and then ask her to do self dilatation, slowly they understand that it's not going to be painful, and maybe that's all they would require. But unless you come and tell the doctors, we don't know that this is the problem.
And many people also, ma'am, it is the friends who have told it's very painful. So it is only that psychological feel that it's going to be painful, and they avoid having. And all this, now both men and women are working, and both one will be working in morning shift, another one will be working in night shift, and they will hardly get time to meet each other. And their frequency of intercourse also will be very, very rare. Mm. Or some people will say once a month or once in 2 months. How will they catch ovulation if they do? So we need to educate them and ask them to reorganize their schedule so that they will be able to catch the ovulation and achieve a pregnancy.
So history is extremely important,
yes, ma'am,
to find out all these things. Plus, like you had already mentioned, medication also, yes, is extremely important.
So any surgeries, all this is very important. And if required, only physical examination, which will be done by an andrologist, that is a male fertility specialist, will be referring to them.
And what specifically would they look for?
They will be looking mainly for their weight, that is BMI. High BMI also can have effect on the spermatogenesis or the production of the sperm. And looking at the genitalia for any hypospadiasis, as what you told, whether the meatus, opening of the urethra, is in the right place, or that the scrotum contains the testis, what is the size, consistency, is there any evidence of varicose?
So all this, you get an idea when we do the examination itself. We get an idea that, and the whole idea of taking a proper history and doing a complete examination, what will it guide us to?
Investigation, what is required.
So it is, this is a stepwise procedure, and it should be done like this, because there is no point in just going and doing investigations. There are a battery of investigations which are available. And whether you really need to know for which particular patient you need to do which investigation, this is true for all patients and specifically for the men. So what would be the relevant investigation?
First and foremost, simple thing would be semen analysis. We do the semen analysis. There are various parameters which we need to see. Just semen analysis gives us quantity and quality of the liquid part, that is the semen, and the sperm as well. We need to know the volume. This is the WHO 2010 fifth edition criteria, what they're giving. Minimum requirement, 1.5 ml is the volume, what they say. As already we spoke, whether collection, if they have 0.5, 0.2 ml, when they have, that makes us, prompt us to ask us question, whether really that was so much, whether they had difficulty and they have spilled the sample. If they feel that they have not collected properly, we will ask them to give another sample at a later date. Or if they say no, it is only so much, then we have to think, is there any block in the passage where it is coming?
So each of this is very important.
Yes.
Because each will give us a clue as to what could be the possible problem. And that is why, though they have given a range, this is the minimum cutoff. It should be little above this at every level.
Yeah. And the sperm concentration. Minimum what is required is the 15 million spermatozoa per ml. There are people for just 1 or 2 million also doing IUIs. See, by knowing what is the count, it will guide us what kind of treatment to be given to the couple. If it is very minimal, if there are no sperms, then we have to get investigation and see whether there is production at the testis level. And if there is very minimal, like say less than 1 million, they have to go in for ICSI, that is intracytoplasmic injection of the sperm. If it is about 5 million or so, they can try, if from the female partner everything is fine, they can try IVF. If it is around 12, 15 million and they have been trying simple thing, we can give them a chance to see for a IUI.
So about 10
as well.
Million is the cutoff.
Yes.
We believe that anything less than between 5 and 10 million, obviously. Less than 5 million, definitely no. Okay. So 5 to 10 million, we can give them a chance. But again, we counsel them that, look, your chances of success with IUI, generally with everything being normal only, in the best of centers, it's around 20%. So with this kind of account, it's probably lower, but you can take a chance.
Okay. And then coming to the motility, total motility. Motility is around 32%. We need basically progressive. Yes, if they are sitting there only and slightly twitching, those kind of sperms will not give us pregnancy, because they need to rapidly move, go find the egg, pierce and enter into that. So we need to know whether there is progressive, good progressive motility. And coming to morphology, morphology, at least 4% of the sperm should be normal.
This again, just to remind our viewers, this is again to remind you what Dr. Rajeshwari had put up of the picture of the sperm.
Yes.
That's where the morphology comes, the head, the neck piece, the tail. All that should be looked into, and we should have at least a 4% normal morphology.
Yes, ma'am. I'll just show what are the abnormal in the next slide.
Yeah.
And this semen analysis also gives us a clue that if there is any infection in the genital tract, and do we need to treat them. By simple treatment, many things can be rectified.
Corrected, yeah.
And this is the abnormal shape of the sperm. Every man produce
abnormal sperms.
At least half of the sperms will be abnormal. And this is the normal sperm. That's the head defect. There is a big head, micro head, double head, and there is acrosome cap. That is the cap of the sperm, what I was telling. There are chances that there is no cap at all. And these type of patients, there is difficulty in conception. For these, it helps us to guide. For these, ICSI would be the ideal option for them. So that embryologist selects and directly pierces the egg and puts the sperm into the egg. And coming to the mid-piece can be twisted, crooked, all that, and double tail. And then other one is the tail defect. It is just curved and sat. If there is no movement, then they cannot go and fertilize. For them, we can recommend ICSI again. If there is good motility, then of course they can go for IVF, otherwise it will be ICSI.
So I again want to emphasize what Dr. Rajeshwari has already been telling you all, that it's not only the count of the motility. Yes. The morphology is also equally important
to guide the type of
treatment we would advise them. And there are, I'm sure, we also have seen that a lot of units which give reports of this don't really emphasize too much on morphology, but in our center, we do, and we have found out over years of experience that morphology is also as important as count and motility.
And this tail movement, if there is no tail movement, it's very difficult for us to identify whether it is a live sperm or a dead sperm. But embryologists will be able to, with their technique, able to find out whether it's a live sperm and pick it up. Even though there is no movement, they pick it up and move. And as I told, more than 50% of all men produce abnormal sperms, and more than 50% can be abnormal. Just because the shape and morphology is abnormal, it doesn't mean that genetically also that sperm is abnormal. Genetics abnormality is separate, different, and morphological abnormality is different. Abnormal sperms doesn't mean that they are genetically abnormal sperms. They can be used and you can have a healthy biological child.
It's most probably only the fertilizing capacity gets affected by morphology.
Yes, ma'am. And as we already discussed, who should go for the intrauterine insemination? Who is having difficulty in having intercourse, like hypospadiasis, where they cannot deposit the semen sample at the right place? For them, we'll recommend. And if they have psychological problems, psychosexual dysfunction, no matter how much of counseling, but they are just unable to do it. For them also.
So ejaculatory dysfunction, most of the time.
Yes.
Or erection problems, erectile dysfunction. Yeah. Okay.
They are the ones. And impaired semen sample parameters, as we already discussed.
There is a minimal cutoff. Anything less than 15 million, anything less than the 4% normal morphology, all those really are not to be. Like we discussed, between 10 and 15 million.
Correct. And others, what they mean by saying others is if there is any genetic problem and that is going to be inherited by the baby and they do not want to go in for a very big treatment like IVF. For such people, and if they are open for changing the gamete, they can use a
donor
sample and go in for IUI. Then for who are people whom we recommend IVF or ICSI is, as we discussed, very low motility. If they don't have sperm at all in the semen sample, we may be able to obtain them directly from the testis. If there is blockage, we will get adequate amount. But if there is no blockage, even if there is minimal amount of production of the sperm is happening, they can retrieve that by surgical technique and use them for ICSI. And the couple do have the chance of having their own biological child, because outside they might have recommended them to go for donors. And they may not be open for it. They will want to have... Everyone want to have their own biological child. For such people, definitely we can try surgical method and
correct. We this will be spoken of in detail by Dr. Rajshekar and Dr. Vasant in the next coming two sessions. But just want to emphasize to you all, like Dr. Rajeshwari has already said, obstructive azoospermia, we go into the testis, and that is quite commonly done by a lot of people. But to get sperms in non-obstructive azoospermia, we have specialized, we have a specialized technique done by both Dr. Naik and Dr. Vasant, which is called micro-teasing. And we have been able to get sperms and have had pregnancies also.
They'll be able to see it directly where their production is happening.
They use the magnification or even the operative microscope and then do the procedure in order to access the sperms. And so these are the recommendations.
Yeah, as we already told, less than 1 million, definitely it will be an ICSI procedure. Less than up to 5 million, we can recommend IVF. And 10 to 15 would be, below 10, definitely success rate will be less. Above 10 and above 15, definitely the success rate in IUI will be good, 18 to 20%, we can say. And then why do we need to evaluate? Evaluation is try to find out if there is any problem, as we told, there can be non-consummation or infrequent coitus or intercourse. For such people, we can identify, educate them, and then help in natural conception. And then also, if there is any underlying conditions, like they may just present to us with the infertility, but there can be any pituitary tumor or like prolactinomas. So when we do hormone assays after semen analysis, we may identify and further investigations can be done and referred to the appropriate.
So routinely, we will not suggest a hormone test for everybody. No, we only suggest a seminal assay.
Yes, depending on that and physical history, what we take. Then only we take investigation. First basic thing is semen analysis. After that, if we feel there is any problem, then we do one scrotal Doppler's to see for the varicose vein. Then depending on that, FSH, test hormone analysis like FSH, testosterone can be done. And then if we feel the decreased libido, people do say we do not have interest at all. For them, if there is hyperprolactinemia, increased prolactin hormone also can reduce the interest in having intercourse. We do all these type of tests in such.
So coming back, history very important.
Yes.
Basic seminal assay is the primary investigation which is recommended. In select cases, we would do a scrotal Doppler and hormone assay.
Then if there is any genetic problem, and when we do the chromosomal analysis, but they have very low, less than 5 million and all, we definitely have to do karyotyping and see what, if there's any problem, and why microdeletion as well, to counsel them. If it is going to be a male offspring, there are chances, increased chance of the male baby inheriting the same problem as the father has. Another thing is in this microdeletion, whether we have to try the surgical procedure itself. There are certain deletions where we will not find, and it wouldn't be recommended.
It's not recommended to do it because we know we are not going to get sperms.
Yes.
So that is why doing this Y chromosome deletion is also to counsel the patient whether it is worth doing the
procedure.
Try to aspirate whatever microteaser from the testis.
And then refer the patients when there is very low, and in the centers, if they are not doing this IVF or ICSI, those patients can be referred to the right center, tertiary center, where all these facilities are available. And one more thing I would like to emphasize is lifestyle changes. Reducing the weight and having optimum, it's very easy for me to tell, having optimum weight and taking diet which is having plenty of antioxidants, vitamins, multivitamins, and reducing the stress, all this can also have influence on the sperm production.
Smoking
and alcohol, also reducing the alcohol intakes. This smoking can have effect on the break on the DNA of the sperm, which can cause breakage of it. And if they do the lifestyle changes also, to see the effect, they need a minimum on the sperm morphology or count or motility. It will take a minimum of three months.
Okay. So these are doable things. Lifestyle changes is possible if the patient makes up their mind that we have this problem, and if we do this, there is a high chance that whatever problem, especially as far as semen parameters are concerned, can get corrected. And further, we may not require any other treatment. We can still conceive very naturally. That is why lifestyle changes are extremely important. And if at all in that particular center it's not possible, depending on what the
please refer
to higher centers where at least the couple can benefit from that particular problem and whatever is the treatment recommended for that.
Rather than doing something simple which is
doing repeated cycles and cycles of IUI, which we know in the end really doesn't help the patient at all, because studies have shown that anything more than 3 cycles of IUI, especially when they already have a low sperm count, really doesn't work.
Improve their.
So the time to pregnancy you have to reduce, because all these are highly stressed, anxious patients, and we just have to help them the best way we can. Okay, so that we have just very broadly covered what should be happened. I would like Dr. Rajeshwari also to tell me, in part of the investigations, yes, we have spoken about seminal essay. In the seminal essay, more normal things we would be looking for is the count, the motility, and also as far as this thing is concerned, the morphology. Is there something called a DFI, and would we do it for everybody?
Ma'am, DFI is basically...
What does it stand for?
It is breakage in the DNA of the sperm. This breakage...
So basically DNA fragmentation index.
A fragmentation index.
This is something like a new kid on the block and everybody wants to do it for everybody. It's really not recommended.
People who are smokers or having a long duration of infertility, or it is older men, for these people definitely we would recommend
to see. Or if they've had many cycles of failed IUI, even with everything being normal, we would like to know this.
Yes, ma'am.
And okay, suppose they find that the DFI is high.
DFI is high doesn't mean to tell us that it will not fertilize. That can be slightly, some studies have told shown that there can be slightly increased chance of miscarriage. Definitely it will continue, but some slightly increased chance of miscarriage. So we can recommend to change their lifestyle, increase antioxidant diet, and give them also some medication like in the form of antioxidant. How far it will help, we do not know. But this is the basic thing or the minimum things what we have to help them out to decrease the
DFI.
And even one more thing they say is frequent ejaculation also can reduce the fragmentation.
So in this particular set of patients, we would also recommend a DFI, not for everybody.
Yes.
And then depending on what the DFI comes out, we would counsel them accordingly. I think we have sort of covered most of it. And we just would like you to... if you have any questions, you can either text it now or text it at Ask Gunashila in any time later, and we'll definitely reply to you. And go to the next one. Can I just have the next slide? Because I just want to show you that the subsequent 2 presentations will be done by our... So we will be talking in the next one, will be more about male infertility. It's a continuation of the same series. And they will be speaking to you all about medical management next Saturday. Dr. Rachika Nayak and Dr. Vasant, who deal with this in our hospital. And subsequent to that, the following Saturday after that, will be on the surgical management of male infertility. Thank you for listening in, and we'll take any questions which you have.